Good morning. Marjorie Rice, I'm your worship associate this morning. Whomever you are, whomever you love, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. We are so happy that you've chosen this YouTube channel, this Sabbath, this sanctuary and time. We know that you have so many options on Sunday morning, and that you choose to be here is something that we celebrate. We extend an especially warm welcome to our visitors and anyone who may be watching on service online for the first time. Take a moment to say hello to old friends, new friends, and especially anyone who may be with us for the first time. Remember, we were all newcomers once. And if you're joining us online, please say hi in the chat. Now we invite everyone to rise and greet each other.
Good morning. I have just a few announcements. The food pantry is in need of people with pickup trucks or people who can drive a truck. They need help on the second and fourth Tuesday of the month at 8:30 a.m. to pick up for the pantry. They also need help on Monday mornings picking up at the Dollar General on 75th and Neiman. There is some lifting required. So if you are interested in this volunteer opportunity, please reach out to Vaughn Gibbons, or you can connect with Haley in the office, and she will make sure you get connected to the right people. Also, in April, there will be a new display of art in the Jerry Hollenbeek Art Gallery. The new display, titled Celestial Escape, will feature the work of SMUUCh member Heidi Peace Bachtarova. On Monday, April 8th, there will be an artist reception in Fellowship Hall from 5 to 7 p.m. All are welcome. There'll be more information in your All Church email. Also, I just wanted to say there is no youth class today. Unfortunately, Kevin and his family got a stomach bug, so maybe send some good vibes their way. Thank you.
This is a call to weep, to rage, to raise our voices, to get real with the words and the wishing for the world to look different, for the breaking to stop, the healing to hold. This is a call to courage, to let in all the headlines and to know them as family. Our brother fleeing Ukraine. Our teenage cousin wondering their worth in Texas. Our frightened friends across the nation worried about losing rights to their own bodies. Our uncle in Michigan unsure whom to trust. This is a call to hear each other. And the one more thing that has tipped our days over or saved us from the brink, brought us back from the edge, or let us go, finally, surrendering in the mystery. This is a call to praise the presence of partners who will greet us in rooms on Sunday mornings and in the streets when the siren calls. Partners who will break bread and set the tea kettle to boil and sit down for long sighs and deep belly laughter. This is a call to gratitude that we are not alone, that we are part of the great history of partners who have promised to go the way of love, that we can travel these days together and remind each other of all this beauty. This is a call to worship together. Would you rise in body or spirit for our opening hymn, Love Will Guide Us, number 131 in the gray hymnal.
As Jen lights the chalice, we invite you to join us as we recite our covenant. Let us affirm that love is the doctrine of this church, the quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and freedom, to serve humanity in fellowship, to the end that all souls shall grow into harmony with the divine. Thus do we covenant with one another.
All right, at this time, I'd like to invite all the children to join me up front for time for all ages. Welcome. Hello. All right. Raise your hand if you've seen the movie Moana. Cindy has. I think several of you probably have. I love that movie. Moana is a movie about a little girl who lives on an island with her family. Moana is very interested in her ancestors' history of sailing and voyaging from island to island. Moana's island has provided all the food and protection her family has needed for generations. But then the island begins experiencing a environmental catastrophe. Their crops are failing and their coconuts are turning black. In order to save her family and the islands, the ocean calls Moana to go on a quest to return the stolen hearts of the goddess of creation. Does anyone remember what that goddess's name was? No? Tafiti, who has the power, she has the power to restore balance to the earth. Even though Moana's dad tries to keep her from leaving the island, Moana decides to take the risk. And she takes so many risks. She has never sailed before, so sailing beyond the reef is a big risk. Once she actually gets over the reef, she experiences a storm and becomes shipwrecked. She's attacked by coconut monsters. Yeah, coconut monsters. Remember them in the movie? And then the biggest risk of all is facing Taka. Taka is a giant fire goddess who throws lava at Moana as she tries to return the sacred heart and restore harmony to the earth. Moana could have turned back at any point on her journey, but she didn't. She took so many risks to save her family and their islands. Why do you think what do you think allowed her to take those risks? What did maybe Moana have that allowed her to take those risks? Anyone have an idea? I think the answer is love. She took risks because she loved her family, the lands, their way of life. I think she also took risks because she loved herself. Like her ancestors, she sailed across the ocean, and Moana had a desire to sail too, and she loved herself enough to learn how to fulfill her destiny, even if it was risky. She risked losing her relationship with her father, who did not want her to leave the islands. She also risked her life. She could have died in the ocean. Life is full of risk, and it might be hard to know sometimes which ones to take. Today is Palm Sunday, and I have something for you. I brought some palm leaves. Here, everyone take a palm leaf. Today is Palm Sunday, and lots of people all around the world are celebrating another story of great risk. In this story, the Roman Empire controlled a place called Jerusalem where a man named Jesus lived. Under Roman rule, there was much conflict, death, disease. People were losing their connection to the land and to each other. Anyone who spoke out against the empire risked death. But Jesus had a vision of a different kind of kingdom, a different world where people loved each other and the earth, and where everyone's needs were taken care of. So on Palm Sunday, Jesus took a big risk and traveled to Jerusalem, sharing the good news of this new kingdom where everyone was loved and taken care of. It was said that they laid these palm branches down on the road as he entered the city. There will be times in your life when you wonder if you should take a risk, if you should try something new, if you should stand up for yourself or other people. These palm leaves are quite fun. But here's the thing. If you're wondering if you should take a risk or not, if the risk increases the amount of love you and others will experience, it might just be worth it. All right, boys, let's head to our classrooms and talk some more about Palm Sunday. Please join me in singing out the children.
Go now in peace, go now in peace. May the spirit of love surround you everywhere, everywhere you may go. I can almost see it, that dream I'm dreaming, but there's a voice inside my head saying, you'll never reach it. Every step I'm taking, every move I make feels lost with no direction. My faith is shaking, but I gotta keep trying. Gotta keep my head held high. There's always gonna be another mountain. I'm always gonna wanna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes I'm gonna have to lose. Ain't about how fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side. To climb. The struggles I'm facing, the chances I'm taking, sometimes may not be down, but no, I'm not breaking. I may not know it, but these are the moments that I'm gonna remember most, yeah. I've just gotta keep going, and I've got to be strong. Just keep on pushing on, 'cause there's always gonna be another mountain. I'm always gonna wanna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes I'm gonna have to lose. How fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side. It's a climb. Yeah. Another mountain. I'm always gonna wanna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes I'm gonna have to lose. Ain't about how fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side. It's a
we come to this place to see and to be seen. We come to hear and to be heard. And we also come to place our joys and our sorrows in front of our congregation. So if you have a joy or a sorrow to share, I now invite you to come forward and light a candle. You can state your joy or sorrow in a phrase or two, a word, or if you'd prefer, you can just light your candle in silence.
Hi, I'm Heather Tice and my husband Blake, and we have a joy about our son James.
Yeah. Well, I've made my college choice, and I'm going to Bowling Green State University in Ohio, so I'm really excited for college. Yeah.
Good morning, I'm Jim Christ. I have two candles. The first one is a candle of great sorrow. The Johnson County gardening community lost a champion earlier this month with the passing of Dennis Patton. Dennis was the coordinator of the Master Gardener program for many years, and he was my personal friend, mentor, inspiration. He taught me how not to take myself so seriously as a gardener, and he will be greatly missed. He was 64. The other candle is a candle of concern and care for Rebecca Reagan, who injured her shoulder recently and will be undergoing shoulder replacement surgery on Friday. It would be great if you all could send her a card. She's in the church directory. If you didn't know, we have a church directory. We do. If you'd like to find it, or just get her address, see me after the service.
This week, a retina place is going to stick a needle in my eye. Then the other one's for my grandson, ups and downs.
I'll light one more candle for all those joys and sorrows left unspoken today, but held close to our hearts. This blessing was written by Andre Mall in honor of two Unitarians, Martha and Waitsill Sharp, who during World War II dared to risk their own comfort in order to help save the lives of those in desperate need. As we gather together, may we remember, when you share with me what is most important to you,
That is where listening begins. When I show you that I hear you, when I say your life matters, that is where compassion begins. When I open the door to greet you, that is where hospitality begins. When I venture out to bring you to shelter, that is where love begins. When I risk my comfort to ease your suffering, when I act against hatred, violence, and injustice, that is where courage begins. When we experience the full presence of each other, because of our shared humanity, because of our differences, that is where holy gratitude begins. May this space be a table that is not complete until all are welcome. May this table be a space of beauty where together we create a series of miracles and where all that we share is sacred.
Hear these words from Gretchen Haley. All you can do is walk into Jerusalem with the hosannas ringing in your ears and the palms coming at you in every direction when you're already remembering the bitter of what comes next. Even then, all you have is the moving forward into the city and the call that says, you've been preparing for this all your life. That every good thing will come undone does not make it all make-believe. And when the world turns upside down and lovers become strangers and thieves and betrayers turn out to be the beloved beside you in the dark, even when the palms turn to passion, even then, you can still throw your arms open wide and turn forgiveness over and over on your tongue until it just falls out and you find yourself empty of everything for a moment. Until the breath begins again, the rise and the fall, and the next morning comes, gloriously steady with life.
All you can do is walk into Jerusalem with the hosannas ringing in your ears and the palms coming at you in every direction when you're already remembering the bitter of what comes next, says our reading. And well, not true, actually. In the Palm Sunday narrative of Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem, this procession was a choice. There could have been other options, including not going there at all. And this was the most provocative, high-visibility plan, and the one most likely to lead to violence. It didn't take supernatural intuition to understand the obvious risk, the high likelihood of the tragedy that would come next. To Christians, this is the start of the beloved narrative of the last week of Jesus' earthly ministry. It first appears in the Gospel of Mark, the very first written story that exists of the events of Jesus' birth, life, and death. Biblical scholars recognize the four Gospels called Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John as stories composed by unknown authors addressed to very specific audiences at different times and places with different agendas. They're very diverse in style and content and sometimes conflict with one another, drawing as they do from ever-evolving oral traditions. In my UU seminary, students were required to take one basic course in Christian scriptures. And most of us had only a passing familiarity with the Bible at that point or ancient church history. In previous years, students had had to go outside the UU sphere to get this credit from a mainstream Christian seminary. But by the time it was my turn, our UU theological school had recruited a biblical scholar who was also an Episcopal priest to teach us the most elementary of the scriptural basics that a Unitarian Universalist minister would need to know about the tradition in which we're rooted and the larger culture in which we're exercising our calling. Should have been a no-brainer. And yet, I vividly remember the incredulity of our professor at the reaction of most of us UU students. Because we felt blindsided by biblical knowledge that had apparently been accepted by mainstream Christian cultures for 100 years. And some of us felt sort of angry, as though we'd been deceived by the stories we thought we knew, when actually we'd just never been interested enough to explore what we remembered from Sunday school. Our poor professor, the Episcopal priest, who'd obviously expected to be teaching a bunch of open-minded graduate divinity students, was like, "What is wrong with you people? How is it you don't know this stuff? What on earth is surprising you here?" Well, here's one example. Most of us didn't know that the very earliest Christian writings were the letters of Paul the Apostle, so Acts, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, written to already established Christian congregations throughout the Mediterranean area. And he was writing to these early churches starting about 20 years after Jesus was crucified. But the writings about Jesus himself, the Gospels, the virgin birth, loaves and fishes, Good Samaritan, Sermon on the Mount, Last Supper, crucifixion, the earliest of these was the Gospel of Mark, written about two decades after Paul, about 70 AD. All of which is to say, the early Christian churches were founded entirely based on oral tradition handed down from many sources, and the written narrative that would shape and teach the religion to be handed down were introduced decades later. And these were stories, each representing the author's interpretation and purposes, not facts, not presented as facts, but brimming with meaning, meant to help teach a new way to live in a shattered, brutalized world. It's our loss if we miss the richness and the relevancy of those meanings because we're intent on disproving what we thought were supposed to be facts. So, the Palm Sunday narrative first shows up in the Gospel of Mark, 70 AD. This unknown Jewish author was writing to what remained of his community in Jerusalem. It had been the capital of Israel for 1,000 years, during which time it had been conquered, liberated, reconquered. So just 63 years before the time of Jesus, the Romans had invaded and established a system of brutal oppression. When revolution broke out just before Jesus' time, Roman legions marched in to destroy cities, massacre people, sell survivors into slavery, publicly crucify rebels in frenzies of terrorism. They established themselves as rulers of the sacred temple, a great humiliation and sacrilege to the Jews. It was in this historical context that the narrative of Jesus' life takes place during that ongoing Roman occupation. And then just 35 years after his crucifixion, almost certainly an actual event, the situation again erupted in violence. This time, the Romans had had enough. They tore down the great temple, persecuted and slaughtered and exiled Jews, an atrocity that has had tragic repercussions for the world down through history to this day. So right here in 70 AD, a time of despair and hopelessness, Mark writes for his people the story of Jesus' last week of ministry 40 years earlier. It begins on the first day of Passover, the most sacred week of the Jewish year, an ancient celebration of liberation from oppression. And it's standard practice for the Roman governors of Judea to show up in force in Jerusalem for this event, expecting trouble. Every year on Passover, they stage an intimidating imperial procession, well known and expected in first century Jerusalem. So on this first day of Passover, Pontius Pilate marches into the city from the west at the head of a column of imperial cavalry with the usual ostentatious display of power. Armor, helmets, weapons, drums, leather sandals marching in unison. Entering from the east is a peasant procession led by Jesus of Nazareth, riding a colt down from the Mount of Olives, cheered by his followers. Biblical scholars tell us this has all the markings of a prearranged counter-procession. Earlier, as Jesus approached the city from Galilee, he told two of his disciples to go to the next village and find him a young colt. Not a symbol lost on the Jewish writer's audience, the ancient Hebrew prophet Zechariah had prophesied that a king would ride into Jerusalem on a colt to banish war and command peace to the nations. So his people procure the colt, and in the face of the brutal imperial presence, Jesus rides the colt into the city, surrounded by a crowd of enthusiastic believers who spread their cloaks and palm branches on the road, shouting, "Hosanna!" Often translated as an exclamation of praise, but in ancient Hebrew means, "Please save us." The provocation is deliberate, as is the contrast between the two processions, one displaying power and the threat of violence, the other peace and compassion. And in fact, there you have the central theme, the essence of the whole rest of the story. Jesus' decision to take this risk and the risks to follow is part of an overall strategy to repair a world broken by violence and injustice. And history is filled with such sacred stories, most of them factual. In other times and places where courageous people have chosen to live out their values in spite of the inherent dangers. And so we remember and honor Harriet Tubman, who led her people out of slavery in the American South. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who confronted the powerful forces of economic injustice by starting the Poor People's Campaign. Emma Gonzalez and David Hogg, who survived the high school shooting in Parkland, Florida, refusing to be intimidated as they raised their voices for gun control. Unitarian Universalist Viola Liuzzo, murdered by the Ku Klux Klan in Selma, Alabama, as she helped black people register to vote. 23-year-old American peace activist Rachel Corrie, crushed by an Israeli bulldozer in 2003 as she stood in front of it to protect the home of a Palestinian family from demolition. These are all dramatic stories of risk, commitment and risk. All of our commitments to change, especially when facing powerful resistance, involve danger, but not necessarily, and not even usually, physical danger. But the danger that comes from opening our minds to peoples or ideas we might prefer to avoid, or to painful realities about ourselves or our history. The Palm Sunday story is meant to move us emotionally, to touch our conscience, to challenge us. All these stories call us to ask ourselves some tough questions. When do we move forward and risk things we might care about a great deal? Our reputation, our economic status, our relationships, our peace of mind, in order to live out what we ultimately feel to be our highest values. What have we learned from past experience? What should or could we have done but failed to do? When did we let fear or self-interest prevail over love? What does it mean when we get it wrong, drop out, fail to live up to our own expectation when it gets too hard? Jesus' disciples are committed to his mission when they march triumphantly with him into Jerusalem, and within the week throw him under the bus and desert him when confronted with the reality of just what they're risking. And these questions have no obvious answers. In fact, they lead to more questions in the process of discernment about any commitment we might undertake. Who might be harmed? What unforeseen elements are there that we have no control of? Do we have the resources to stay the course? Who will be our allies and companions on this journey? And what if it all doesn't go as planned? Spoiler alert, it won't. Consider then what might guide us. Love. Love doesn't always give us answers. But what about if we asked ourselves in pondering every choice, every decision, what course of action is most likely to bring more love into this hurting world? If we chose to act in the service of love as we best understand it, how might the future be kinder and fairer, even in ways we won't live to see? What does love call us to do? I know that you, as a congregation, have experience with this process. I know that you have history with answering the call of love. I don't know all the details, But many of you were part of this church's major undertaking in choosing to use your resources to help people without homes be safe, and then to establish a food pantry right here in the heart of Johnson County where no such help existed. And it must have been obvious from the start that there were risks inherent in your commitment. As I remember it from a distance, there were obstacles with the law, the neighbors, funding, logistics. I can't imagine there wasn't some internal conflict. And a pandemic. And through it all, you've set an example of risking a difficult commitment centered in love. An example for the neighborhood, for other religious communities, and I imagine for the local government. And along the way, you've probably learned that this work is transformative, involving as it does, making mistakes, having second thoughts, practicing forgiveness and grace toward yourselves and each other, staying intentional and moving forward, even as old assumptions about your way of being in the community and the world dissolve. And you find yourselves that much closer to being who you truly are. Because you chose to be guided by love. And bless you for that. I've been studying a book called Fierce Love. It's by the Reverend Dr. Jackie Lewis, who has come to believe that love is, or should be, at the very heart of religion. Reverend Lewis is senior minister of Middle Collegiate Church in New York City. She's the executive director of the Middle Project that prepares leaders for a more just society. And she's a frequent contributor to UU resources, and she's created programming for PBS, MSNBC, and more. One of Reverend Lewis's most powerful stories in the book, to me, is her recounting of a church youth group trip she took during the summer after her freshman year in high school. During the two-hour drive to the church camp in Michigan, she and her friend Leslie made plans to bunk together in the girls' cabin. And Leslie's mother, referred to as Mrs. R, was one of the chaperones. Reverend Lewis describes her as a wiry, strident lady, strict, but also funny and kind. Well, the oldest kids on the trip were seniors who for months had been planning just how wild they would get on this camp trip. And those plans were realized on the next to the last night at camp. All the kids were allowed to go sit on the beach, play their boomboxes, and dance around the campfire unchaperoned until their 11 o'clock curfew. Jackie and Leslie sat by the fire watching, feeling a little awkward as younger kids. But fortunately, it was getting close to the curfew, so the girls headed back to their cabin. Jackie felt good about being back 10 minutes before a curfew. But Mrs. R greeted them scowling, demanding to know where the rest of the girls were. "They're not far behind," Jackie and Leslie assured her. Mrs. R was furious. "You should have waited for them and brought them back with you," she said. "It's not enough that you followed the rules. You're all responsible to each other. They are your people." And with that, Mrs. R punished the girls by making them sit on Leslie's bunk, backs against the wall, to wait for the others to come to bed. Those others showed up at 1 a.m., all partied out. They'd get their own punishment in due course, but in the short term, they all got a talking to over breakfast. They needed to learn, Mrs. R reiterated, that our success and our thriving are not individual projects. Our choices impact our families and communities. And Reverend Lewis remembers, When we had quiet time that afternoon, I spread my towel on the beach and lay down, watching the clouds move slowly across the bluest blue sky. I let Mrs. R's admonition wash over and through me. I felt the truth of what she said deep within me. Looking back, I can see that this moment and her words planted seeds in me that would eventually grow into a new theological self. Everything, my spiritual maturation, my grown-up faith, my preaching, teaching, writing, activism, and advocacy, all would become a quest to leave no one behind. Along the way, I would shed the belief system of my childhood and build a wider tent for myself and others so we would get to healing and liberation together. I would claim a universalist faith, bound in freedom and love for all people. And to me, this is inspiration is a gift from the Black community of Reverend Lewis's youth to all people of faith, and so needed, especially in this moment, in this brutal and wounded and frightening world of 2024. She writes, in its truest sense, religion should reconnect human beings, bind them again to the creation, to one another, to the divine, to love. In the interest of exorcising hate, I find myself preaching and teaching folks to see through the eyes of love, to believe with all their heart in love. My new religion is love. Fierce love, period. That's all that matters. For the future of our children, for the survival of the world, that we might make it through the next days and all the days to come, may we remember that ultimately, in all things, and in spite of all the risks, love is all that matters. Amen.
Well, we got lost. The work of the church depends on us, our time, our giving, and us being there. Okay, I don't have it. So now, give generously, please, at time for our basket. It went away.
Love changes everything, hands and faces, earth and sky. Love, love changes everything, how you live and how you die. Love can make the summer fly, or a night seem like a lifetime. Love, love changes everything. Now I tremble at your name. Nothing in the world will ever be the same. Love, love changes everything. Days are long, mean more. Love can can break the strongest heart. Pain is deeper than before. Love will turn your world around, and that world will last forever. Yes, love, love changes everything, brings you glory, brings you shame. Nothing in the world will ever be the same. Off into the world we go, planning futures, shaping years. Love bursts out and suddenly all our wisdom disappears. Love makes fools of everyone. All the rules we make are broken. Yes, love, love changes everything. Live or perish in its flame. Love will never, never, never be the same. Love will never, never let you be the same.
Extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Please rise as you are willing and able for our closing hymn, Life Calls Us On.
Now we gather for the blessings we have known, with a pledge to one another that we journey not alone. Joy and sorrow make us one, before us, waking here to keep us strong. Blend our voices in the chorus of creation's living song. Courage bids us lift our voice upwards to shining skies. Hope lives us on. Hope calls us on. Loyal guards in love and duty, lead us with a trusted love. Faith calls us on. have shared a radiant hour when the truth has made us free and the Spirit's gracious power.
Words of that hymn written by the Reverend Dr. Kendall Gibbons, the All Souls Sister Congregation. And I offer you these closing words by Wayne Arneson. Take courage, friends. The way is often hard, the path is never clear, and the stakes are very high. Take courage, for deep down there is another truth. You are not alone. Go in peace.